Yeah, I'm working on 70 MRI and some MRI guided tumor therapy fusion machines like MR guided RF hypersomia system or MR guided, last year we worked on MR guided LINAC system also. I'll go to the second slide. And this slide shows the content of my presentation. First, I will briefly introduce the system we are going to use at KBSI, and then my major topic on dipole antenna, and then maybe I can remove this screen to add my screen. Yeah. Dipole antenna, and then some other topics on EM simulation on monopole antenna. We have done some work on this, and also phantoms we may constructed for 70 RF coil. And if I have more time, then I'll talk about briefly on MR safety, RF coils, and also some works. It's not ultra high field MRI, but the frequency is very low, about 13 megahertz. But I'll talk about MRI compatible RF hypersomia systems. Anyway, so this is the introduction of Philips MRI Achiva 70 system at KBSI, and it was installed on 2015. It's about slightly more than 1 year ago. And recently, we just finished the installation of a few RF coils, and we finished some tests, some simple pulse sequences. And right now, we are doing research on 70 MRI RF coils and some techniques like rapid imaging or B1 imaging or etc. And our plan is to do some more research on some high-resolution images and fMRI, and also later some more clinical applications like Alzheimer's disease or Parkinson's disease, and so on. We have many coils here, like head coil and some knee and proton animal coils. All of them are in Korea right now, and also numbers up to num we have more than 10 coils right now, but wrist and extremity coil, etc., and phosphorus, sodium, carbon. But right now we are working on only brain imaging. And for me, I have not tested the rest of coils, so that's what we will work on later. Yeah. This is one of the volunteer images we have taken by using our 70 MRI machine, and it has a good resolution, but still we should work on many things like our own RF coils and other pulse sequences. There are some susceptibility weighted images, and later we'll have. I'm sorry for the Koreans written here. Anyway, currently we have multi-channel eight-channel transmission RF amplifiers and cabinets for them, but in a year or so, we will also get some cable management system and the interface box and the RF transmission coils for head and 32-channel receiver coils in combination with all those hardwares. So we will be able to use this in addition to that, we'll be using and the RF coils we constructed by ourselves, like the dipole antenna or monopole antenna. And if we can, we can also try the RF coils you people had constructed in Germany, I think. So about the dipole antenna RF coil design, well, everybody knows about this. For high field system has very good signal to noise ratio and the spectral resolution, but it has very non-uniform B1 field, like, and also depending on the application, it has a high SAR, has a problem in RF power deposition. So we should be very careful in designing and constructing RF coils, especially for body coil. So that's what, this is what we are going to work on. Since our machine is for whole body imaging, as the first trial, we'll make a dipole whole body RF coil, and we are now designing and we are testing part of the coils. I did go back. Okay, yeah. So what we're going to generate, make is something like this, and so our purpose is increase the uniformity of B1 field distribution, and we are trying to make it uniform in not only in XY plane but also in Z direction. So to do that, we optimize the current distribution along the wire of dipole antenna. Also, we can change the length of the dipole antenna by putting this this tappet. We call it tappet, but it's a small circle or half circle connected at the end of the dipole antenna. We modify it like that and somehow optimize this to get the best uniform field, beyond field in Z as well as XY direction. We try to compare a loop and the dipole antennas at the beginning, and this image shows the simulated field map from dipole antenna and one loop coil with similar size and identical transmission power. Of course, as you can see, dipole antenna seems to be more efficient and field can go deeper into the body. We tried four types of different dipole antennas, like here we have original dipole antenna, and we have full disk tappet dipole antenna, and here we have half disk tappet dipole antenna, and also we can have some other flat disk, or even some other groups are trying some other shapes, like tree shape or complex snake-like structure. So we are going to optimize the structure of the coil and the length, and then we'll optimize the current magnitude and phase for eight transmission elements. This shows the B1 distribution along the Z-axis for some different designs. And first is the B1 field distribution along the Z direction. And this B1 distribution shows using the top head, we can increase the uniformity in the Z direction. And the second figure is the surface current distribution. It's not B1, it's a current distribution. And the third figure shows the B1 non-uniformity calculated by B1 distribution. And if we, from this figure, we conclude that half disk tappet dipole antenna here, as you can see here, number 5 in the at the center, shows the best uniformity. But I think this is just a calculation result. So we are going to generate some images by optimizing the coil and actually construct and getting image, and we should get B1 mapping, and we should confirm this result later. So and then by using 8 transmission channels, we optimize the phase and the magnitude to get the best field uniformity, and the axial and coronal B1 maps are here, and as you see, without optimization here, as you can see some non-uniformity, and if we put some just same by putting the identical 45 degree phase change with the circular polarization, we have a better uniformity. And here in the third image, we optimize the phase and magnitude. I don't have a magnitude and the phase numbers here, but obviously the result shows the uniform field. And numbers shows like 13 or 54 for circular polarization, and with the shimming, we have much improved uniformity. But still, we may have some problem in SAR near the arm, I think, here. So circular polarization, both circular polarization and RF, with the RF shimming optimization, we have some high SAR here. So that's something we have to take care of for body imaging. Yeah. Currently, we are checking just tuning range and Q and optimal length, and trying to tune it in the magnet bore, because so far we have tried the outside shield room. So right now we are trying the inside magnet bore, and soon we will try 8 parallel transmission. It shows the sum of the half circular top head structure. Later, we're going to generate this kind of construct, this kind of RF coil later, like 8 channel like this, and 3 at the bottom. And I think this is digital phantom, this is somewhat smaller than, and it was, and we need to optimize the size of the frame, I think. Okay, yeah. In summary, yeah, we think by using top head dipole antenna structure, we can get higher uniformity and higher spatial coverage, and well, hopefully less SAR compared to original dipole antenna array. Before trying that, we did some EM simulation for monopole antenna before, so I'll show this result also. The reason why we tried this is we wanted to do some brain imaging, and before volunteer or human imaging, we wanted to check by using some brain, the head-like phantom. So for that, we needed to do some simulation on that. And based on the simulation, we wanted to make the phantom. This is the structure of the monopole antenna. This is a flat ground, and there are 8 rods, half of the dipole structure. And here, to make the phantom, in the simulation, we put different structures with various combination of ingredients on it, like sodium chloride or some other stuffs to change T1 or T2 or conductivity, and also the susceptibility. And this shows the right, the left image just shows the case for cylindrical phantom, and the content was average of white matter and gray matter. That's what we tried at the beginning. And with the, if we put some brain shape like this, this is a uniform head and the same white matter and gray matter property, and looks they look similar in this case. And this is another one. The multilayer head is close to actual brain, and on the right, on the left is the white matter, gray matter average ingredient inside the phantom, and they look similar here. And here, on the to check the our goal was by changing the permittivity and the conductivity of the phantom, we wanted the similar field pattern as the multilayer head. This is a digital phantom for which is believed to be close to actual head. So by changing the permittivity and the conductivity of the phantom, we found that about 78 of relative permittivity and 1 Siemens per meter of conductivity. In this case, we found that the field pattern is similar to the actual multilayer head case. So this is a summary. I explained it already, so we'll go to the next. So based on that, and by trying some more ingredients, we tried some more phantom combinations. If we put distilled water, the field is very different from the multilayer head. So I think it cannot use distilled water for our phantom. And we found that. And also here, uniform head and the cylinder phantom, you can and check the field, it's similar, but we have some, for uniform head, we have some problem in the nodes, and we should modify the RF coil structure. So we may make the hole or whatever. We need to do some work here. So we tried many different combinations of epsilon and sigma, as you can see here. And assuming that multilayer is the ideal brain case, and the white matter, gray matter average, and the CSF also averaged, or the SPIG, the parameters, the SPIG sent to us, and it was somewhat different from multilayer. And distilled water is not good. And among these, we found that epsilon r of like 76 and the sigma of 0.8 or 1.0 seems to be giving us the result close to the multilayer case. So we constructed the phantom by using these parameters. It was done by making the phantom frame by acquiring MR image of human brain, human head, and then by segmenting the MRI image and in 3D, we make the phantom like this by using 3D printer. Actually, this is my head. Well, I don't know whether you can recognize this, but anyway, by making small hole at the bottom, we can put the fluid as we have chosen in the previous slide. And we are trying imaging by using this phantom. Currently we using only two channel transmission brain RF coil, NOVA, from NOVA, and the solid channel receiver RF coils like this. And by using this kind of scanning protocol, we did some phantom image and check, we are checking the performance of the RF coil. But I haven't done any, but volunteer imaging by myself, but soon I think we can try our some complex sequences by using this RF coil, and also we can check the system by using this phantom more frequently. Yeah. Well, I how many minutes do I have more? I think. Tim?
Yes. Yeah.
How much do I have more?
Time. 10 minutes. You have around 10 minutes. So.
Ah, I see. Thank you. And when making or doing simulation on the RF coil, we are focusing on the SAR. But from last year's ISMRM, everybody is talking about actual temperature. Because even if SAR is very high, actual temperature could be low. And even with low SAR values, temperature could go up. So we should check temperature rather than heat generation or SAR. So for MR safety purpose, many people are talking about temperature simulation and checking the temperature. Since while working on the MRI guided RF hypersomnia or other therapy MRI fusion systems, we worked on the temperature simulation. We are going to also do some simulation on the RF, on the temperature from the RF coil driving, and also we will do actual imaging, temperature imaging to confirm the simulation result. Here are some images, some abstracts in this year's ISMRM. I just quickly review this about two or three papers. Here we have 7 Tesla breast coil work, and SAR versus tissue temperature limit is studied here. RF safety of RF coils can be assessed mostly based on SAR, but we should check temperature, and temperature is actually directly correlated to the tissue damage. Even in SAR is compared with due to some thermal regulation, temperature limits are exceeded up to 6 degrees in some subjects, and for health subjects, up to 40% higher input power is allowed if temperature limits are applied instead of SAR. So we should be careful on temperature increase, or sometimes if we can check the temperature exactly, we can put more stronger RF pulses than we can do for only SAR is used. And this is the 70 breast coil work, and the next one is this is somewhat similar to what we've been doing for RF hypersomnia. This is on RF heating studies on anesthetized peak by using dipole antenna at 70. The figure one shows the digital peak model constructed using the high resolution CT images here. And the figure two shows temperature distribution obtained as a result of 15 minute heating with the dipole antenna. The fractional dipole was excited with 20 watts of RMS power, which results in SAR level that are higher than conventional limit. So, and the third paper is about the using hypermittivity pads on human head at the sodium resonance frequency at 7 Tesla. They reported that when high dielectric permittivity pads were used, certain combinations of pad position, geometry, and material properties can lead to significant SAR elevation. So the pad with a permittivity of 500 and thickness 10 millimeter shows the more than 80% SAR increase in Duke model. Even dielectric pad shows good results at high hydrogen resonance imaging. But for ex-nuclei resonance imaging, we should be careful about using the pad. And next one, well, from RF field, there are many effects here. Among these, temperature seems to be the most important parameter when talking about the safety, I think. Well, FDA is talking about this SAR limit, and also mostly government regulations are about SAR, but temperature should be checked, and I think in addition to EM simulation, we should also work on the simulation on actual temperature effect. Yeah, temperature is increasing. This is from this paper. Yeah. So we did some simulation on temperature for RF hypothermia or other purposes. So this is, we are just talking about this heat source here. This is the heat generated by RF coil, could be RF coil or some other RF, some heat source anyway. Yeah. And the heat diffusion should be checked. This is about heat diffusion, and this is heat convection. This shows the cooling or heating from the blood flow. So based on all these kind of terms, we can simulate the change of the temperature. Well, the model is very important, and for the damage of the tissue, we can use some different models like this. And one of them is, well, this CEM model is used frequently, especially when you, especially for hypothermia treatment. I was told that this CEM model is used. This equation is derived by integrating the time for different temperatures, like if it's lower than 43 degrees, then it's weighted to 0.25, and it's more than 43 degrees, it's weighted for 0.5, and with different factors like this. And the last 20 presentation is about MRI compatible RF hypothermia. Last 2 or 3 years we worked on this. So RF hypothermia uses electrode here, top and bottom, and by using about, in this case, we are using 13.5 megahertz. And from this 2 electrodes, RF current is derived, and in this low frequency, the body can be mostly conductive. I mean, and the heat is mostly generated by current rather than displacement current. So in this case, we can do some low frequency approximation. We can assume just that the heat is generated by steady current. You can use low frequency approximation. So we made RF hypothermia electrode compatible to MRI high magnetic field, and we made some RF coils which are compatible to RF hypersomnia system electrode here, and we tried it on a peak. Peak each weight is about 26 kilogram, 20 to 25 kilogram, and we applied 100 to 140 watt power here, as you can see in this magnet. And we applied it for 20 minutes, and we do temperature imaging for 2 minutes, and then again heating 20 minutes, and the imaging 2 minutes, heating 20 minutes, imaging 2 minutes, and then cooling. While cooling down, we did some more imagings. And we tried it for both phantom and peak, and for phantom, we put like some by putting this kind of ingredients, agarose and sodium chloride and copper sulfate. By changing these numbers, we make the conductivity of tumor region is much higher than the liver region, so the current flows mostly much more than the tumor, more in the tumor region. The conductivity, this concentration is about sodium chloride about 8 times for tumor mimic phantom and liver mimic area. So we did experiment on this, and also we did some simulation on this phantom, and then we did some experiment on the peak, and also by acquiring MR images on the peak and doing segmentation, we were able to do some simulation on RF heat generation, like as you can see here, by using SimpleLife program. So this is the simulation model, and this shows how we did on the peak, actually. So this simulation condition, and 100 watt and background temperature like this. And this simulation result on the phantom, and temperature goes up like this from after 20 minutes, after 40 minutes, after 60 minutes. And well, we do not have a sharp temperature increase for the tumor region, but we have some more increase at the center rather than the area close to the electrode. And actually, according to simulation, the temperature rises around the edge of the tumor, the boundary of the tumor region. So we did not expect a sharp boundary for the temperature rise, but anyway, the temperature goes up more quickly at the center. This is imaging and the simulation result for the peak. The top row shows the simulation result, and the bottom row shows the temperature imaging result for the peak. And here on the top, by using MR image, actually 3D T1 image, I believe, and based on that, we segmented all the organs like this, and we assigned the numbers like this, the conductivity and other parameters, and we used that numbers and the structure for the simulation. And that for the experiment, when doing experiment, we found that this is a stomach, and here we have a gallbladder. And I believe we heard that the pig did not eat quite a long time, like one day or so. And this gallbladder is very big as expected. And you know, this is a very conductive fluid inside the gallbladder. And this conductivity is very high, as you can see. So we may expect much higher current in the gallbladder and more heating for the gallbladder. But anyway, we did based on that kind of theory and imaging result. This is a temperature imaging, and you can see some higher temperature increase in the gallbladder region. So by using graph, we expand this more, and like this. This is a simulation result. This is experimental result. And although there are some artifacts here, around here and here, there are some blood flow and also some susceptibility artifact because there were air inside of it here. So anyway, the temperature is somewhat higher in the gallbladder compared to the liver, as you can see. And in the simulation, we had some similar result. So we tried some other pigs like two or three times, and for this simulation models for number one, number two, and number three. As you can see, gallbladder is smaller, and going to the left somewhat as for the number two and number three peak. I don't know why, but anyway, from MR image, we found that. And this is a temperature image on the right, on the left, and simulation result on the right. And these are the comparison. You saw the first row and the second and the third row. We saw some increase in the gallbladder, but it's small. So, but we saw some increase in the temperature in the simulation as well as in the temperature imaging. But I think we need to study more on this. And our actual purpose was whether temperature estimation by using simulation and actual temperature measurement using MRI are identical or not. But right now, we found that they are at least the error is less than 3 or 4 degrees, and our first goal was achieved, but we are going to study more later. Yeah, I think that was the last slide, and thank you for your attention.
Okay.